Call of the Crocodile, part one of the critically acclaimed Call anthology series by up-and-coming author F. Gardner is the most thrilling book of the year. With bone-chilling horror and imaginative writing, Call of the Crocodile is a must-read for the Halloween season. What's that? The check bounced. Frank's out of money. Okay. Call of the Crocodile is the biggest piece of shit I've ever had to read.
If your path at midnight dark by a graveyard goes, someone whistles, let it do, that's mysterious moan, or on some dark stormy night.
Welcome to a special Halloween video. I'm recording all this in a bit of a rush to get it out before Halloween is over, since I've spent the last 2 days in recovery after drinking a bottle of rum to myself and projectile vomiting all over my mattress.
Our young generation is clearly lost, man. Clearly lost, man.
It is the fall season. Spooky white girl, pumpkin spice Dutch Bros month. It's that time. Time to dress up, hang out with friends, do blackface and shit yourself at the dorm party.
Oh yeah, give it a sniffaroo.
Or you record a book review because you didn't go to any parties or were invited or have any friends to invite them. But hey, you guys are my friends, right? Right? Unless you've been living under a rock or don't frequent Mongolian basket weaving forums, you've probably heard of Call of the Crocodile or at least have seen this incredible cover. A horror anthology by F. Gardner. And there's the man himself, grinning ear to ear on the back. He's a serious author, guys. He's just like F. Scott Fitzgerald, bros. For the sake of brevity and to not feed into his weird LARP, we're just gonna be referring to him as Frank for this video. So why are we talking about Frank? Who is this guy? Why is he important? What is this book? Why does the cover look like a kid with Down syndrome made it? Okay, well, let me explain. Frank Gardner, this beautiful man you see before you, wrote a book. And instead of posting on his Wattpad or his DeviantArt or hitting the delete button, instead of doing all that, Frank here, in all his hubris, decided to spam the shit out of 4chan's literature board. Mind you, this is the same book that misspells rifle in the first paragraph.
What are you, Down syndrome?
This was the product that Frank needed to spread. Well, Frank, buddy, you got what you wanted. And faintly, in the background, you could hear the sound of the monkey's paw curl. As Joaquin Phoenix says in the award-winning film Joker 2019, you get what you fucking deserve. Before we get into the kino, that is Call of the Crocodile, I want to have a quick discussion on book covers. Physiognomy is one of the most important things in life. It's how you represent yourself to the outside world. If you come up to me and you got on your Bape shirt, Supreme crowbar in hand, got the mixed race perm, you start flossing, we like Fortnite, we like Fortnite, we like Fortnite. I'm probably gonna think you're a zoomer. You like to vape in the school bathroom. Damn, for real, deadass? That shit's busted. If someone comes up to me, they got on a large tweed coat, got on wool dress pants, looking like Frog and Toad, Uniqlo trench coat, literally just bought everything off the dark academia chart. I can tell that you're a bit of a LARPer. You fall for memes and trends, and you spend too much time on Reddit, and you're not very bright. All this to say, what's the first thought that comes to mind when I show you the cover for Call of the Crocodile? Does it set your expectations high? Are you prepared to read the next great horror novel of our time? No, it looks like poo, bro. This is like a child's drawing. You put it up on the fridge, Frank, right next to the B+ on your spelling test.
I've got a friend who's big and round and oh so jolly gee whiz.
Lend me your ear and you will hear just who this fellow is. He's Punky Pumpkin, the Happy Pumpkin, happy all the day.
Call of the Crocodile is a masterful display on how to not only fuck up a very simple premise, but how to completely shit your pants and spill your spaghetti all over the floor. The spaghetti's out of your pocket, Frank. You can't, try as you can, you're on the floor, the spaghetti's everywhere. Put the spaghetti back in your pocket, playa. This book reminds me, here's a side tangent for you. This book reminds me a lot of a Spanish teacher I had in high school. We'll call him Groiper, since he was shaped like one.
Groiper, Groiper.
Big fat Mormon guy. He was writing a book, and on the last day that he was teaching, because he couldn't pass the test to continue to be a teacher, he would read it to us. So he brought in his book. It was like about the Knights of the Round Table being transported to modern day to like high school or something. It was some shit a teenage girl would write. And I'm sitting there in class thinking, like, isn't it crazy that if I'm not here, if I don't listen to this griper read his Wattpad journal to us, I'll get in trouble. I will be reprimanded for not participating in this classroom activity of listening to a man's pathetic midlife crisis. Crazy world. I love the U.S. education system. I do. Anyway, not to get lost in the weeds here, the look on Groiper's face when he read off his fanfic, I imagine, is the same smug face Frank had when he printed off his first copy of Call of the Crocodile. Both the results of a midlife crisis, really. Okay, let's get into the plot already. My eyes grow weary on this Hollow's Eve. Just as a heads up, I did end up listening to the audiobook that some saint ended up recording for most of the book. So maybe Frank's a genius. The audiobook didn't do his masterful writing justice. Maybe the sky is fucking green, cows flying. Okay, so let me explain the premise. You got dad, name is Joe. You got non-present mom, died of cancer, HIV, left to get cigarettes. We don't know, dead. You got three brothers, Rafe, the oldest. You got Jimmy and Pete, who's dead too, from Crocodile.
Double kill.
And this is the premise. Dad and his two sons going over to the grandma's house on Halloween, on the anniversary of the death of their brother and son from a fatal crocodile incident. And they are forced to deal with the grief and sorrow surrounding that, personified by vivid hallucinations and nightmares. Simple idea. Can be a nice short story, all wrapped up neat. Would make a perfect 30-minute Goosebumps episode. Roll the credits. But Frank didn't go that route. That would have had a beginning, middle, and end with actual character growth. So let's get into this. The first chapter takes place a year previous to the events of the book, detailing how Pete, the youngest son, wanders off at a theme park on Halloween and gets eaten by a crocodile. And just by this first chapter, you can start to pick up on a staple of Frank's writing. That is, subtlety is dead. I'm a little baby idiot pea brain. Please spoon feed everything to me. Throughout this chapter, one idea is drilled into your head over and over and over again. Pete's eyes are green, the boy with green eyes tells the man. The boy remarks, with the pupils of his green eyes constricting. Pete was wearing an outfit which was green as his eyes, as Pete's green eyes gaze at it from a distance. Pete's green eyes widen with impatience. Wow, I wonder if this character's green eyes will have anything to do with the green crocodile. He even just says it in chapter 6, as green as the crocodile that took your life. This is just emblematic of a larger issue of Frank's writing, where he either thinks his writing isn't good enough to convey subtle imagery and metaphors, or he thinks people reading it are idiots. I would lean more towards the latter, personally, knowing Frank. Anyway, Pete gets eaten. One year later, the family gets ready to go to Grandma's house for Halloween. And here we see the first of many signs of DeviantArt, Wattpad, creepypasta tier writing, which is references to pop culture or other literary works. It's like how high school girls write. It's embarrassing. I just picture Frank laying on his stomach on his bed, kicking up his feet, giggling as he writes this out with his fuzzy pen. What kind of great book relies on another book to describe how a character is feeling? More than that, Joe is beginning to feel like Sisyphus. Describes his feelings, infernal, as the word inferno, the chapter from Dante's Divine Comedy, Purgatorio, and then finally Paradiso, Purgatory and Paradise. As the poet Delmore Schwartz famously coined, time is the fire in which we burn. Truly pathetic writing. Grown-ass man. So Jimmy and Rafe are taken to the office of the head priest of the Catholic school that they attend in order to talk about how they are feeling, as it is about to be the one-year anniversary of the brother's death. We are then treated to some incredible NPC dialogue with Frank's critique around organized religion. Boys, I'm aware of the significance of today's date to the both of you. Yes, Father O'Reilly, I know too, grimaced Rafe. I'm sorry, I didn't intend to make you cry, Father O'Reilly said, placing his hand on the boy's shoulder and attempting to comfort the boy. Although he can't imagine what they're going through, he went on how they'll one day be reunited with their brother. When will that be? Asked Jimmy. When? Once we're in heaven, of course, remarks the priest. So not till I'm dead? After I'm grown up and old? I don't want to wait that long, the boy said softly. Maybe if the second coming happens in your lifetime, then I suppose it would happen sooner. Interested, Jimmy looks at the priest and holds back his tears. Father O'Reilly didn't want to give the child false hope. How will I know when that is? Jimmy asked. Struggling for the right words to say to the child, Father O'Reilly reflects on the question. I'm afraid no one really knows, my boy. Not even the apostles and disciples of Christ really knew. That's actually part of why it took so long for the scriptures to be completed. They didn't see any need to hurry up and rush writing the whole Bible because they just naturally assumed that Jesus would be coming back within their lifetime. So that's why the Bible has so many inconsistencies in it.
Stop! You violated the law!
After coming home, we are introduced back to the dad, Joe, who has now been so grief-stricken. He is an alcoholic.
Daring today, aren't we?
During an appointment with his psychiatrist, Dr. Boltzmann, remember that, that's important, Joe explains his psychological dilemma by referencing better books. Oh my god, I'm just like Dante. I'm just like Ryan Gosling in Drive. He's just like me. How do you do, fellow lit users? Let's just fast forward to when they arrive at Grandma's house. No one is at the door as they arrive. The house is hot and humid and dark. You know, when I think of a scary environment for a horror story, I think of Grandma's house. Candy in a bowl. Fresh baked cookies. Doilies everywhere. Those little pillows all over the bed. Smells nice. Shaking just thinking about it. They can't find Grandma, so the two kids decide to play hide and seek while the dad starts cooking dinner. As the older brother, Rafe, is looking for Jimmy, he catches a glimpse of his grandma in a room. He watches her as she climbs into a dresser drawer, contorting her body to fit, and closes it. Sounds pretty sick to me.
Now, if you excuse me, I have some business to attend to.
Break all my bones and slither into my underwear drawer. He walks by to find his grandma, along with his brother and father in the kitchen, because guess what?
It was all a dream!
And you better get used to that, because that's another one of the book's most obnoxious trends. You know that cliche where someone in a story has a weird, surreal thing happen to them, only for them to wake up and it just be a dream, having only a faint memory of it? Well, imagine if that was an entire book, and imagine you bought this book for full retail price. Now imagine you are reading that book and reviewing it and editing a YouTube video instead of spending time with friends, loved ones. Sounds like hell to me. Now, you may think it was bad to pay money for this book since you're directly encouraging the behavior, but you have to realize
it's not about money, it's about sending a message.
Speaking of buying the book, I have made a quick tutorial on things you could use your copy of Call of the Crocodile on if you were dumb enough to buy it like me.
Okay, so you just bought your copy of Call of the Crocodile off Amazon. Your wife is yelling at you, you're children are crying, they're hungry, you can't afford to feed them. All while Frank is diving in your pool of pennies like Scrooge McDuck. So I'm gonna show you today some uses you could get out of your Call the Crocodile book. Because it's not like you're gonna read it. No sane person would read this book. So here's some quick tips and tricks I could give you. So make sure you grab your copy of Call the Crocodile and follow along with me at home. Bang.
Swat some flies with it.
It got delivered like this. Okay, so first use you could get out of your Call the Crocodile book is a drink coaster. Okay, you could pour your drinks on there. All right, you see that? Maybe a little bit more. Maybe a little bit more.
It's gonna be a long day.
Oh, that was for you, Frank. Now, if you see, it looks like we spilled a little on it. Now, that's not a problem. So this is actually where you bring out your copy of Call the Cherokee, right? Take a page like this. There you go. You want to fold it up, okay? You want to fold it up, absorb it like a sponge, okay? Pat it, circles, little circles like that. And there we go, clean as a whistle right there. Another interesting thing about the paper is it's actually made out of rolling paper. So if you take a piece like that, you roll it up, put your weed in there, and there you go. You could probably, find a way to smoke crack with this. The next great use, of Call the Crocodile, and this is perfect for the fall season we're coming into. It's starting to rain a little bit more. You know, it's getting colder, it's starting to snow. Is a doormat. Now look at that. You won't get that type of absorption of dirt and grime. You won't get that from just any book, okay? This is special. This is perfectly made for wiping your shit and piss and cum all over it. A less common one that people don't know is you could actually use these as oven mitts. And the great thing about these is after you use them, you know, you get them all dirty and stuff. These are actually machine washable. Make sure it's on hot, of course. You open it up and just drop it in. So the family sits down to eat their Halloween dinner, after which the dad tells everybody they should head to bed. Dad, it's 6:30. Get to bed, goddammit. The plot needs us asleep. Frank is out of material. When they are in bed, we are treated with not one, not two, not three, but four dream sequences. And here is another massive problem with the book. We don't have any stakes. There's not a single example of the results of these hallucinations manifesting at all in reality. For all we know, as a reader, these visions are just that. They're vision. And without having any fear that our characters may be harmed in any way, there is no stakes, and therefore no reason for me to be invested at all. This just makes the book extremely frustrating and annoying. There's even some cool imagery in some of these dreams. There's a part where they're stuck inside like a pumpkin has a heart, a beating pumpkin heart in the center. That's not bad. That's not bad imagery. But without an actual threat, that's all it is. Just imagine 100+ pages of a character having a dream, waking up, going, wow, that was a weird dream. Whoa, was that a dream? Did I dream that? Whoa, that was a crazy dream. And at this point in the book, I was really about to call it quits. It was just annoying me more than anything else. Until I got to a part of the book, and I read the most unintentionally hilarious scene in any book I've gone through.
My bed belonged to Pompadour. Like Lulu, I have bright red hair. I dance as well as Salome and treat my Baptists just as fair. I wear Mata Hari.
So after the numerous dreams on Halloween night, the family wakes up the next day to make breakfast. Joe, the father, is helping Grandma in the kitchen when he finally inquires, "Mom, what's in the oven?" "Oh, you'll see soon. It's a surprise," says Grandma. Now let me ask you, what do you think could be in that oven? A crocodile, perhaps? I laughed when I thought of that. But as I read on, I realized, no, he's legitimately scared that Grandma is cooking a crocodile for breakfast. I won't be able to convey the true Kino quality of this scene without just reading the words right off the pages. So here is my dramatic reading of the breakfast scene reenacted in MS Paint. A strange image of a hypothetical meal had arisen in his mind. Ha! That's ridiculous. That would never happen. Why would I even think that? Joe thought to himself. She could be cooking anything. Why did an idea like that even pop into my head? Glancing over at the oven, Joe began wondering what resided within it. Can you at least give me a hint at what it is? Hints, Joe? I know you're curious, but no, I don't think so. I don't want to give away the surprise. Getting this meal ready wasn't an easy thing to do. In fact, it was quite an endeavor. Joe shuddered and halted his cleaning and thought about what she had said. There's no way that— Mom,
what do you mean by that?
Just get ready, dear. The dishes are clean enough.
Mom, please tell me this isn't what I think it is, he said as he grabbed his mother's shoulder.
Hey, you've gotten soap on me now. I'd better go change out of this.
Should I open it? Joe wondered.
Hey, what's cooking in there? It smells good, Jimmy remarks.
Wait, Jimmy. The concerned father quickly shouted. The boy jumped in confusion.
Is something wrong, Dad? I was just curious is all. I could help you out if you want me to.
Shit. How should I handle this? I need to get him out of the room quickly, but I don't want him to freak out.
No, everything is okay. I need you to go back to your room for just a couple more minutes while I get breakfast ready with Grandma.
All right, Jimmy's out of the room. If the thing in the oven is really what I fear it could be, then he shouldn't see it.
Could it really be? Joe continued thinking, his mind now racing.
Is she really cooking a crocodile?
No, not the heckin' crocodile.
Oh my god.
Now, where's everyone else? I don't know about you, but I'm famished, his mother says.
I can't believe what you've done here, Joe says.
What did I do?
God, Mom, Jimmy and Rafe are here. Do you really think that's something they need to see?
God knows it hasn't been an easy past year for us. Don't you think this would only stir things up?
Am I getting across?
Joe, I really have no idea what you're saying here.
For the love of God, do you honestly not see the problem with this? Were you really going to try to feed them that?
It seems there's been a huge misunderstanding here, Joe.
Oh, yes, there has been. He glances over at the oven. I don't even want to see it at this point, the man thought to himself. It's just too morbid.
Is the duck almost ready? Asked Jimmy.
What did you think it was? Wait a minute. Oh my god. Did you think that I cooked a crocodile? I mean,
it doesn't even make sense. How would I even get a crocodile? We're in Illinois. I'm elderly.
Are you retarded, Joe? Okay, I'm sorry. Jimmy, help us set up the table.
Dad, you already made the table. Did you forget? Jimmy says.
What? No, I didn't. Joe looks over to see the table is already set.
I didn't make it.
Was it your brother?
Maybe it was
the crocodile. Bum, 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 bum.
Okay. I'm done. Can we get a round of applause for the greatest scene ever written, please? Editor's note, I'm editing this right now and I just picked up on the fact that Jimmy went from wondering what was for breakfast to immediately knowing it was duck. So that's something. It may come as a surprise, but after this, there are more dreams. Who would have thought? In true Shyamalan fashion, Gardner hits us with a twist in chapter 16. The setting stars Pete's in a treehouse, and he's with two friends we've never heard of, and they're talking about how they're going to do a ritual to bring to life characters that they've written. It's a theory that was proposed by Dr. Boltzmann, and the characters' names are Joe and Jimmy and Rafe and... Do you get it now?
Could you hear that? Did that pick up on the mic? The sound of my eyes rolling into the back of my skull.
So this whole story was actually a story inside of a story written by Pete.
Oh, brother, this guy stinks!
What a twist. Make me want to twist my fucking neck.
There is one of the biggest signs of bad fan fiction writing.
Meta story.
Don't know how to end your story? It was meta, bro. It's a story in a story.
Don't do this ever. This sucks. This is the most hack writing ever. Don't do this. So anyway, Pete writes all these characters into a story, including himself, and on Halloween night, they complete the ritual, and he gets sucked into the world that he created. Now, at this point, I was like, all right, I can see where this is going. He will be sucked into the body of himself in the story he made without having any control, will have to be eaten alive in an ironic twist, succumbed to the fate that he created. Is it a good ending? No, it's bad, but it works. Cut it up into 30 minutes, there's your Goosebumps episode, okay? Nice little short story. But what if I told you,
instead of that, Pete gets taken to the edges of reality, where he meets the shadowy gnome pixies who run the world, and gains consciousness and senses beyond human comprehension, and then he's sucked back into his reality where he remembers none of it? And what if I told you that once back into this world, a shadowy cult creates a plan to lure in Pete by purchasing Dracula's fucking castle, transporting it into downtown Chicago, making it into a resort so they can recruit Pete to write characters for the world reset as they burn down the resort and everyone inside as one massive human sacrifice.
I'm done. I'm fucking done.
How? How do you fuck up this bad? There's pixies, there's gnomes, there's a vampire.
I just got a fucking brain aneurysm from reading that. I think I'm done. In almost every situation, I value the creator over the critic. It takes no skill to point at something and laugh and say it's bad. Who am I? I've never written a horror anthology before, and if I did, it would probably be just as bad. The problem here is that Frank Gardner shilled this, spammed it constantly, because he thought he was that guy. Well, I'm here to tell you, Frank.
You're not that guy, pal. Trust me. You're not that guy.
Anyway, guys, I hope you all have a nice Halloween. Let me know in the comments what your trick-or-treating costume is. I will be going as a Gorn from Star Trek original series. They can't tell how old I am when I'm in my Gorn costume. All right, happy Halloween. Love you. Bye.
Strange enchantment fills the moonrise. There's a breeze like sandalwood and wine.